Well, good evening, everyone. Great to see you tonight in the house of the Lord, and we give God praise for another wonderful day to be back in His house, and thank God for the grace that He gives us and the opportunities that He gives us to be able to trust in Him and lean on the Lord. We want to give God thanksgiving for all that God has already done in our lives, what God is doing. We want to give Him praise and thanksgiving, and thank Him for being so good. Please, I remember our youth as they're meeting together tonight, so pray for them, that God will just bless them, and pray for us as a church as we go forward, now that God will give us direction over these next few weeks and what we need to do in the upcoming days as far as continuing on with Sunday school, trying to get some things back engaged and going. So please pray for that, that God would give us leadership and guidance in those things, that the Lord just help us to know what to do, to encourage others and reach out to them. And then also pray for Brother Travis with Christ Life Church. They're going to be having their first worship service on September the 19th in the it'll be outside. So pray for that and ask the Lord's blessing on it, and just ask for God's guidance through that. And we're looking forward to what God is going to do in and through Christ Life Church as we continue to pray for them. So we praise God for these opportunities, and pray for our missionaries out in the field all around the world. A lot of our missionaries are having a hard time because of all the things of churches not being able to meet, and so there's not as much support that is going out, so those things are going to be affecting a lot that is happening. And so I encourage you to continue to give as we support and encourage and pray for our missionaries, that God would just bless them and anoint them. I would ask you to pray for tonight before we go to the Lord in prayer. Please pray for Trissy Andrews. She's going to be having surgery tomorrow, so please pray for her. And then also pray for her son, Bobby. He is in the hospital down at Raleigh, so really in a tough situation health-wise. Pray that God would just, I believe he's on a ventilator and other things, so pray that God would just touch him and lift him up, and the Lord just give them peace. And then also I ask you to pray for our family. Pray for my dad. Continue to pray for him. He is one of these, we don't know what to say other than a miracle at this time. So it is pretty amazing. If some of you may have read today, has about 15 to 5 this morning. He just looked over at me and said, "Well, I'm still alive." So he's expecting any second to leave here, but he's enjoying it while he's here. So we just praise the Lord for all that God has done, and the Lord giving him strength over these last few days. And so continue to pray for our family, and I appreciate all the texts and the calls and everyone who sent us a message just praying for us. What a blessing that is. So I want to thank you as a church family already for all that you have done in our lives, and we want to tell you we love you and just praise God. It's good to be in the family of God. Amen. And good to know the Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer tonight and just ask the Lord's will to be done. Let's pray for all of our churches across our land. I know there's a lot going on. I know in California, a lot of churches are facing some very difficult decisions in this day. So pray for them. God will lift them up. Let's pray together. Father, we love you. God, we want to thank you tonight for the privilege just to call upon your name. God, we just want to thank you for your love, for your grace, for your mercy, for your salvation, for the blood that you shed so that we could be saved. God, I just want to tell you today, I love you, and thank you, God, for opening my eyes. Thank you for opening my heart to your word, God, so that I can know you and trust in you and to be born again. And Father, no, we just want to come together as a church family tonight. God, we ask you to bless our youth as they meet together. God, just anoint them. Father, we pray for every other group, our Bible studies that are happening. God, you would just anoint them. Father, I pray, God, that you just speak to us as we are here tonight to know your will and your desire, God, and your word. Lord, that you would help us, Lord, that you would encourage us, Lord, that you would strengthen us through your word, and God, you would fill our lives with your presence and power. Father, we just ask you
God, right now, how, Lord, to touch every single need that is in this building. Lord, we come together as a church family, God. I just want to pray for Bobby Andrews. God, you would touch him out there in the hospital at Raleigh, Lord, and just put your hand up on him and lift him up. God, we pray for Tressie. Lord, you would bless her tomorrow as she has surgery. We pray for healing. We pray for strength. God, we pray for peace, Lord, around her life. And God, that you would just lift her up and just meet her needs. And Father, we know, God, that you're the God who is able. And we pray also for the family tomorrow that will be having a service here, Lord, that you would touch them and lift them up. God, I pray for healing and strength around them, God, that you would just meet their needs. And Lord, I know that you are the God, Lord, who's able to bring comfort and peace. And Father, thank you for answering prayer, God. In my dad's life, I pray you just continue, Lord, to touch him and lift him up. And thank you for the grace that you give us every single day. Father, we just come before you to pray, God, for our own community, Lord, that you would bless our community. God, you would touch this community. God, to come together to know you and to trust you and to be born again. And Father, now we pray, God, for all those who are sick through our community. You bless them. I pray for strength in their life, Lord. I pray for grace. Lord, I pray we lift them up even right now, Father, with a healing touch as only you can do. And Father, now we just pray, God, that you bless all of our leaders. God, from our president, Lord, our vice president, God, our Senate, our Congress, Lord, our House of Representatives. Father, we pray you would just, Lord, you would turn their hearts to you. I pray for every person in those positions that know you as Savior and Lord, that they would become a bold witness, Lord, and they would exalt you and lift you up, and God, they would, that you would work through their lives, God, to be a witness. And Father, we pray for our governor. We pray, God, Lord, also, God, we pray for our county commissioners, Lord, our school board. Lord, we pray, God, for all of our elected officials and our town councils and our mayors, Lord, you would give them wisdom as they lead through this time. Lord, help us all, God, to be supportive encouragers, oh God, and reaching out with the light of the gospel that people may know and see and trust in you. Father, thank you for all that you've already done in our lives. Lord, thank you for the prayers you have answered. God, we just want to give you praise. Hey, you're a God who knows every single need that we have, even before we ask. And I want to give you praise, Lord. God, we want to give you thanksgiving for what you're doing right now, God, through your word. Lord, we want to thank you today, Lord, for your love, for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for dying on a cross for our sins. And Lord, I want to praise you that you rose again. And Lord, I pray you'd help us to live for you and lift you up. We commit this time and your word, God, to our hearts today. And God, together right now, that we would not only learn and we would grow, God, but we would apply it in such a way that it will change our lives, that others may know and see you through your word. And we give you praise tonight. In Jesus' wonderful and holy name we pray. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. God is in control. Amen. There's something that we have learned and I have learned personally, even greater in these days, and that is that God is still in control. And I bless his name. And we're going to look at that tonight. I want you to take your Bibles and turn to Acts chapter number 12. The book of Acts and chapter number 12 tonight, as we ask God to speak into us and speak life into us as we look at his word. But when you come to the book of Acts, again, the book of Acts is exactly what it says. It is the acts of God. It is the things that God is doing to his church, to his people in this time period. So we see the acts that are happening through the church. So we're going to look tonight and see what God is saying and what God did. There's a key person that happens in the book of Acts. We have the Apostle Paul, who gets saved and he knows Jesus, and we see him in the latter part of the book of Acts as he grows, as he begins to be that bold witness. Before that, we have somebody in the book of Acts by the name of Peter. Have you ever heard of Peter before? And Peter is the one that God is using. When they heard of Peter, they're like, wow, we know Peter. We hear Peter. We want to hear every word that Peter says because Peter knew the Lord and Peter had the power and the presence of God upon him. And so we're watching that happen through the book of Acts. When you get to Acts chapter number 12, there's something that has been happening before this. The power of the gospel has been spreading across the land. Can I let y'all know something? There are churches all over the United States of America. We have preached the word. We've been faithful to keep our doors open. But something that has been missing in a lot of cases is what was going on in the book of Acts, and that is the power
and the presence of God. And when that began to happen in Acts, because before this time they had had no problems. Before this, they just had this one man by the name of Jesus that they had to deal with, and they tried to silence by putting him on a cross and him dying and being done and being silent. But that did not happen. Neither in the book of Acts, as they tried to silence the church, beginning in Acts chapter number 7, where you find that persecution beginning with Stephen. And they could not silence the church. And I want to tell you, in our day, we've got to have what they had in the book of Acts, and that is a boldness. So the disciples have been experiencing exceeding joy. They've also been experiencing in their life growth as the church went forward. They didn't just stay where they were. They didn't just stay at Jerusalem. Persecution had sent them out, but it did not silence them. We should be sent, not silenced. Amen? And so when we look at what is going on, how we see these things happening all around the church in the book of Acts, how are they going to handle persecution? This is something that is new that they're dealing with. This is something that these disciples have never had to handle before. Although we do read in the scripture that the Bible says that they crucified or they persecuted those who were even before them. But now the church that has risen, that has brought so much joy and gladness and healing, is now experiencing persecution. So far, they have known something, that is that by prayer, everything is handled. They watched Jesus himself, these disciples, handle every situation that they came to with prayer. They watched Jesus handle everything he was about to be involved in by beginning it in prayer. So how are they going to handle what is going on? I want to ask you something. This is a question all of us need to understand today. Can prayer make a difference and bring hope again? We're going to understand that tonight in his word. Prayer is interceding for others or for objects, for things that are happening. And so the burden of the heart that we're going to experience, the burden of the heart leads us to rely upon Jesus and to understand that he is the only one that has the answer. Here, there's bondage that takes place that needs to be broken. When we read these scriptures that we're about to read, they're chains that are upon them. How many of you know somebody right now, they may not be in physical chains or they may be in physical bondage, but they are in chains today to something. Do you know someone like that? And so what happens as we read, I want you to look with me in Acts chapter number 12, and we're going to look at verse number 5. And I want you to think about this question when we read this verse. Can the chains be broken by prayer? Look at it in verse number 5. The Bible said, Peter therefore was kept in prison. So where's Peter? He's in prison. The Bible said, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. We have a description of what it means to intercede. Whenever we pray for things, we are trusting God. We're leaning on God for things or people around our life. When we are interceding, we are saying, God, we want you we're at an intersection, and God, we need you to reach down in this situation, and we need you to change it. God, we're interceding for that person, and we're watching that happen. Interceding means that there's a pleading that is going on before God. And that is what is happening here. This is a prayer for Peter who is in prison. Or we could think it is a prayer for someone who is in bondage. I want you to look back with me. Peter is a true follower of Jesus. But there's something that has happened from verse 1 down to the first part of verse number 5. And that is, there is what the Bible calls a vexing that has happened. The church has been vexed. That little word vexed means, that is there, it means to be, to injure. It means to make an affliction upon. It means that something that is coming against it is an evil affliction. It is an evil effect. It means to bring evil against them or harm or hurt. And that is what has happened. Look in verse number 1. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to do what? Vex certain of the church. So what is happening in verse number 1 is we're understanding what is going on in this time period. There is a persecution that is coming from King Herod. The Bible says now. Well, what has just happened in verse, in chapter number 11 and chapter number 10? We watch God as he is, as the word has been preached and people have come to know Jesus and the power of God is upon the church and they spread out everywhere. And there's even been somebody that has been raised from the dead and Peter has returned to Jerusalem. And so as that happens, that fire that is in King Herod has gotten greater to silence believers. Can I tell you what has happened over our last few weeks and months in America? We are going in the same path that we see that is happening with what King Herod did. They're trying to silence where there would be hope. They're trying to silence what would make a difference. The Bible says in verse number 1, he said that King Herod, he stretched forth his hand. That little word, stretched forth, it means to throw upon or to beat into. So there is a personal vendetta against the church. There is a physical attack that is happening on the church. I don't know how we have missed out on some things that are happening, but there's a lot of Christian people that have been attacked during these things that are happening across our nation. In some of these places behind barricades where they're taking over, some people that are Christians have been going in and there's a lot of people that have been saved. They've been having baptisms on the street. Ain't that a blessing? Amen. At the same time, they have been going against and beating some of these people who are naming the name of Jesus. You say, where's that? That is America. That is the United States of America, places where we would never have dreamed of that it would begin to take place or take place. And so here's these disciples. They have lived for Jesus. They've every time the boat shook a little bit, they said, Jesus, where are you? He came to the rescue, and now they are under a new blanket, if you will, a persecution. If this had happened in Peter's life earlier, he might have denied Christ. Y'all remember Peter, don't you? Why, Peter is that one who stepped out to follow the very first thing. We cannot deny Peter's faith. He knew Jesus, but his faith was also weak in any time there was pressure. And we understand that. So we're looking at what is going on in his life. The Bible says in verse number 2, look at it. And he killed, this is King Herod, he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. We go back to Acts chapter number 7 for just a minute. Anybody remember how Stephen was killed? Stoned. He is stoned to death. And the Bible says now they have went a different route, because when you go in the Bible, in the Old Testament, and you look under Old Testament law, if someone was blaspheming that did not turn, there was a lot of things that people could be stoned by the people for. But now we are seeing another turn. This is something that is happening publicly, and they are crucifying or persecuting Christians who are doing nothing but explaining who Jesus is. And wow, his life is taken. So now we have one of the disciples by the name of James who has been taken. The Bible said he died by the sword. It looks like maybe these other disciples, that they might take the hint that if they killed Jesus and they put Jesus in the grave,
And now here's one of their own just a few months later that has been taken, and now they put him to death. Maybe we should just call this off. Maybe we should just be silent. Maybe we should just do our little thing over here and not really cause a ruckus because that we love Jesus and want people to know Jesus. Let's just be silent over here and get kind of hidden in the corner. No. When they left, they knew something about these men. They knew something about Stephen. They knew something about James, and that is this. They were not dead. They just sent them home. Amen. Can I remind y'all about something? This world is not our home. That we are leaving here, amen? And so we have James who has given his life. There's a vexation that has happened. Look in verse, when you come to verse number 3. But, and then whenever we have King Herod, when he sees this, the Bible says in verse 3 that it pleased the Jews. Oh, they're like, wow, thank you for silencing them. Maybe we can get them back where we can have control over them. They controlled people by religion. Can I let you know something? If religion controls us, we will die. They were controlled by religious rituals. They were controlled by those who led, who had that authority. And so we're watching that happen. And he said it pleased them when they closed the mouth of James. And the Bible said because of that, he went after Peter. Peter is known as, if you will, the pastor of the Jerusalem church, of those believers that are there. And he has been gone out. He is leading all these other places from the Christians in Jerusalem, and now he is back to Jerusalem. They know he is a leader of the church, and they said, oh, let's take his life. And the Bible says here in verse number 4, he said, and when he had apprehended him. So did he catch Peter? He's got Peter. Wow. Verse number 4 is astounding to me, because other than Peter cutting a man's ear off with a sword, we never, ever, ever see Peter being a threat to anyone. We don't see Peter standing up. We don't see Peter doing anything except for preaching the gospel. We see the boldness that is upon Peter. But listen to verse number 4. It said, and when he apprehended him, he put him in prison. So where is he? He's in prison. And the Bible said, and he delivered him to 4 squadrons of soldiers to keep him. That is 16 soldiers to take care of one man. I say wow, don't y'all? He has one offense. His offense to them is that he is preaching the gospel of Jesus. He's not doing anything else. He's not going against anything else. He is preaching Jesus. And the Bible says in verse number 4, he said, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. So what is the king going to do? The king is going to boast himself up and build himself up with the people by bringing Peter out and saying, I want to give you Peter, the one who is causing all of this havoc. I want to give you him just like they did with Jesus. Wow. So he has intentions for Peter, and that is he's going to take Peter. He's going to do him just like Jesus. He's going to put him on a cross just like Jesus. He is going to take him down just like they thought they took Jesus down. And then the Bible lets us know something with these 16 soldiers. They guarded him. He was bound to them. The king is planning the very same thing. And then the Bible says in verse number 5 that we read, he said, but Peter, therefore, was kept in prison. He's got 16 armed guards. He's got 16 people to tell about Jesus. Can I remind y'all about something? We have all kinds of different situations in our life. We have different situations that are happening around us. Can I just let you know something? We need to share Jesus with every situation.
He gives us those opportunities. And we're watching Peter as he is here. I want to let you know, we're living in a day. I want to remind you about something, that Satan wants to silence the church. If he can keep us quiet, we won't spread the gospel. And what is happening is he is trying to quieten down this message that Jesus has died and he's risen again. And if we can do away with that message by doing away with a leader, by doing away with Peter himself, then no one else will hear. There'll be no more havoc going on. And we can have our life back like we used to have it. But I want you to look in verse number 5 again. You understand something about value from verse number 5 all the way down to verse number 10. The Bible says, first of all, in verse number 1 or verse number 5, that his name is Peter. How many of you believe that Peter has value? There is a person involved. Every person counts. Every person is here by the grace of God. Every person that you and I know, everyone that we have seen, everyone we've ever read about in history, they are here by the divine appointment of God. God gives life, amen? And when we see that, we have Peter, wow, he's a life of value, Peter. But in this context, Peter is a man of value because of all of his accomplishments, but because he is a disciple and is leading others, and God is using him, and he has an anointing upon him. God is using him as the forerunner for the gospel to continue to spread around the world. And so what does Satan want to do? He wants to silence the gospel by taking out Simon Peter. And we have him here in prison. He's back at Jerusalem. He is this key leader. Matter of fact, when you think about Peter, I think about what Jesus told Peter right after he told him in the book of Luke, I believe it's chapter 22, when he looks at Peter in the eye and he said, I want you to know something. Satan has desired to have you. Did y'all ever hear Jesus tell that in the book? In Luke, y'all hear that before? He said, Peter, he said, I want you to know, Satan desires to have you that he may sift you as what? As wheat. He wants to tear your life apart. He wants to tear everything that you have in your life out. He wants to take away your faith. He wants to take away your faithfulness. He wants to take away your love that you have for me. So just be reminded that Satan wants to completely destroy who you are. And then here we are. We look at Peter now, and Peter is standing in the place that his life has been more than one time. When you get to chapter number 12, he has been in that place of should I deny or should I stand for Jesus? What is going on? I love what Jesus told him. He said, oh yeah, but Peter, let me tell you something. When you are converted, then you convert others. What was Jesus saying to Peter, this man of value, this one, Peter? He was telling him, I want you to know something. When you understand that you can have faith through every situation, you can pray at all times, that you can lead people to Jesus, that you are the one that is leading the church. He said, when you know that, when you understand that, then tell others. When you have confidence that you are a child of God, tell others. After he was converted, he's converting others. So what's Peter been doing? 3,000 saved, 5,000 saved. The Bible says there's churches that have grown out of those people that Peter led to the Lord, to the word. And now we're seeing that happen. He is a person of value. I'm going to remind you something and me something tonight. You are a person of value to God and to others for the gospel's sake. And Satan wants to stop you. Satan wants to cause us not to be faithful to him or to his way. I want you to look what happened in verse number 5. There's the value of the person, which is Peter, but there's the value of prayer. Do you believe tonight that God answers prayer? And we look and we understand something about prayer. The Bible says prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. They gathered and prayed for Peter. Oh, the people prayed. The church prayed. They instantly turned to prayer. The disciples have discipled the people to do what? What's the people doing? praying. The disciples have discipled the people to pray. He said, look, here is where you are. Here's what you need. Here's what you have to have in your life. This is what we watch Jesus do in every area in his life. This is what we have done as we stepped out and began to follow him. Pray. And the Bible says that they have prayed. And I love what it says in verse number 5 that says they prayed without ceasing. It means they did not quit praying. Church, when we quit praying, we have stopped living. That prayer, that place of prayer, every single day, no matter where we are, somewhere in our life, it is coming together and saying, God, I want to meet with you. I want to trust you. I believe in you. And God, I'm going to trust you for these great things. And here's what happens as we see in verse number 5. A burdened heart that is following Jesus will always pray. Always. It is always the place that you go to first when your heart is burdened. That place of falling up on your knees and believing in God. Oh, and the Bible says the church prayed. The difference of Peter being in prison as we watch him is this. The Bible says, I love verse number 5. The Bible says there's one little word that connects the whole thing together. He said he's in prison, but... He said, but here's what the church did. They prayed. They gathered and they believed God. There's power when you come together to pray. If we are to make a difference, prayer must be made. I want you to look with me in verse number 6 and look what happens. Verse number 6 tells us how Peter is. And when Herod would have brought him forth the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers. So guess what Herod was getting ready to do on this night? He was going to bring him out and kill him. He said when he would have come in and got him and took him, but the Bible said he was asleep between the guards. Now, can I ask y'all something? How in the world could Peter sleep being surrounded by 16 soldiers, chained to them? Where in the world would he ever found the peace to even sleep? I want to tell you, he was believing God. He wasn't looking to the justice system. He wasn't looking to the soldiers. He was looking to the one that was over it all. And the Bible said he was asleep. I don't know if Peter thought it was a vacation. Just thought, man, hey, praise the Lord. We're going to rest right here. The Bible said he is asleep, and he's so asleep. When you look in verse number 6, you understand. He was sleeping between two soldiers. He was bound with chains. He had chains on him. And the keepers before the door kept the prison. So let's just put in our mind in a modern day looking jail, if you will, on the inside, that there's two men that he is chained to, one on each side. That leaves 14 more soldiers just to guard around Peter. And Peter's asleep in the middle of all of it. While we watch as Peter is asleep, and the Bible says here that he is chained up. He is no ordinary prisoner. I kind of got this thought in my mind that maybe King Herod says, well, we know what happened to the one that he was following. They had him bound up that night, and then they put him on a cross, and then they put his body in a tomb, and on the third day, what happened to him? He arose. Maybe Herod is saying, we better guard this Peter guy because he is connected to this Jesus man, and something miraculous might just happen if we don't keep him all the way down. Maybe what is happening today in the church and across church life, across our world, they're realizing that when there is power, when people gather and when they pray and when they trust God, and they want to keep that out of the way. Friend, I want to tell you, listen, Peter is in the middle of being protected. There's no way out, and Peter just sleeps. When you come to verse number 7, I want you to look at it with me. Verse number 7 says, and behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side and raised him up. Aren't you glad he came to you one day? Amen. raised them up, saying, arise up quickly. And his chains fell off his hands. I tell you, when you look at what is going on through prayer, is Peter still in prison? Yes, he is in prison, but they are praying for Peter over here at Mary's house. They are praying for Peter, and while they're praying for Peter, God shines a light into the prison, and the Bible says here in verse number 7 that he says, rise up, and soon as Peter stands up, the chains just fall off of him. Wow. So verse number 7 tells us about something. In prayer, there's a presence. And this presence is no ordinary presence. It's a supernatural presence. What happened in Peter's life was supernatural. God raised him up. God sent an angel out of where Peter is. And he let the light shine. And the chains fell off. Can I just tell you something about being born again? Do you know something about anybody here born again? Hey, do you know what happened to you whenever you got born again? I want to tell you, you were chained by Satan. Satan has his demons around your life to keep you from knowing Jesus. He is trying to bind you. He is trying to keep you in the prison, a cell of sin, and take you in an awful place called hell. He tried to walk in, and God had angels around you to pluck you out that day when you got saved. Oh, but listen, there was another presence that came from another world, and that was Christ. That is the angel of God that has come down. And soon as he came down, he touched you and released you from the binds of Satan. How many of you got set free when you got saved? Amen. Oh, and that's exactly what has just happened to Peter. Matter of fact, when you get to verse number 8, look at it with me. The Bible said, and the angel said unto him, gird thyself and bind on thy sandals. And so he did. And he said unto him, cast thy garment about thee and just follow me. Why? You know something I found out about Peter? Peter learned something about following me. When you hear God, just follow him. Whenever there's an angel comes, just follow him. When you hear Jesus say, come and follow me, you just do what? Follow me. Oh, and here's Peter. He's like, okay. And verse number 9, look at it with me. And he went out and followed him and wist not that it was true which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. So what has just happened in Peter's life? He thinks, man, that prison food's making me have a little dream. He thought, man, I'm having a vision that this is taking place. This does not even seem like reality. Can I just tell you something about God's grace? It don't seem like reality when you're walking in grace. It don't seem like, wow, how could I make it through that? And you understand that God was just carrying you by his grace. And Peter says it don't even seem real what is taking place. And so verse number 10 says it like this. And when they were past the first and the second ward, they came unto the iron gate that leadeth them to the city, which opened to them. So guess what happened? I'm amazed. Y'all ever been amazed when you walk up to a door, it just slides open? They had them all the way back in Peter's day. It happened at the prison. It's the first, as soon as they walked up to the gate, it just opened up and they walked right through. You know what? Nothing is impossible with God. Peter could not get at, look where he's at. He's not in the first ward. He's not on the outside of the prison. He's not in the second ward. He's not in the inner court. He is in the very thing of solitary confinement where he is surrounded totally by the prison itself. And God walks him out every single door. God opens the doors as Peter comes to him. And the Bible says in verse number 10, they went out and passed on through one street, and forthwith the angel departed from him. He just led him out. And just walked on through. Wow. You know what God did? God led him to where he could be set free forever. And so we watch that happen in Peter's life. We see the path that he had. And then you watch, and the Bible says in verse number 11, there's a view that takes place. The Bible said when Peter was come to himself. You ever had something happen? You're like, did that really happen? Anybody ever had that happen before? Oh, he saw the view. And then he got the surety in verse number 11. Here's what he said. Now Peter was come to himself and he said, now I know of a surety that the Lord has sent his angel and hath delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews. Peter said, now I understand. God, you delivered me. Wow. How and why did God deliver Peter? What's happening behind the scenes? They're praying. They're trusting. Peter really don't have any clue. They're down here praying at this house. He just knows that something supernatural has happened. God took the prayers of the people. God heard them in heaven. He sent angels down to release Peter. He sends Peter out the door. And now Peter's like, well, praise the Lord. Let's go to Dairy Queen. Amen. He's like, I'm released. I'm out. Wow, what has just happened in my life? I'm totally 100% set free. And he said, I know what has happened. The Lord has delivered me because no one else could have. Wow, when you watch what is taking place, the Bible says in verse number 12 that he takes a step because he is going to show others what has happened. Look in verse number 12. And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together, doing what? Praying. They're just trusting God. They're praying for Peter. So Peter, his view is he's taking a step. He is stepping out in what God has given him in that he is set free. Oh, and then the Bible says in verse number 13, I love this story, from verse number 13 down to verse number 16, we just have to have the setting of this because they're in the house, they're crying out to God, they're praying with everything in them, they're not ceasing, they're not taking coffee breaks, they're not stopping for snacks, they're praying, they're trusting God. Their heart is burdened because Peter, they know that his life is in the balance. You know what will change our lives? We realize that our prayer could be the difference in somebody living and dying. It can be the difference in somebody going to heaven or going to hell. They are praying. And the Bible says here in these scriptures, as we understand it in verse number 13, listen what happened. The Bible said, and as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken named Rhoda. And when she knew Peter's voice, wow, she opened not the gate for gladness, but ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate. So she heard Peter, and she got so excited that Peter's at the door, she forgot to open the door. And she runs back in the house. And look what happened in verse number 15. How the Bible said, and they said unto her, thou art mad. It's not Peter, but she constantly affirmed that it was even so. And then it said that, oh, it's Peter's angel. I'm not sure if they'd ever been in touch with Peter's angel or not, but they said, oh, it must just be Peter's angel. And then in verse number 16, but Peter continued knocking, and when they had opened the door, saw him, and they were astonished. Wow, their prayer has been answered. You know what they knew? They knew they were praying for something that was impossible with man. They also understood something else. That nothing was going to happen unless God did it. But when they did not believe, they did not see, it was like, well, we know that's probably not Peter, but man, we've been in touch at least with Peter's angel, and he's come. Can I tell you, sometimes whenever you're praying and you're really burdened about something in prayer, you're so amazed whenever God answers that sometimes you're left speechless in what God has done. And the Bible says here that they were astonished, oh, when they saw him. And then in verse number 17, the Bible says, in verse 17 here, he said, but he, beckoning unto them with a hand to hold their peace, declared unto them how the Lord had brought him out of prison. Isn't that amazing? They're getting to listen to the story of how God answered their prayers. I want to remind you about something. God answers prayer. Listen, don't ever shortchange God. He always answers prayer. I just feel impressed tonight to tell this story, and I've told this story a few times over since it happened some years ago, but it was for my grandpa. And I know I've told about praying for him before. We prayed for him and prayed for him and had all kind of people praying for my dad's dad. And we were praying that God would touch him and God would save him, because he would say, you'd ask him, I'd say, you know, my grandpa, he was already up in his 80s. I'd say, you know, do you know Jesus and are you sure? He said, well, no, I'm not saved. And you're like, man, growing up, I just thought all older people were born again. Until I started driving, amen. Y'all get that. I kept asking, Paul, are you saved? No. Lord ever deal with you? Yes, he does. He went to church every Sunday. And he would stand in church and be under that place where God was speaking to him about getting saved. People would say that he would hold on to the pew until his knuckles were completely white, trying to keep from going to the altar to be saved. And we kept praying and praying, and God, would you touch him? And Lord, we just want you to save him. They would go on vacation, and so sometimes I would have to go do stuff at their house. So what I would do, I would just go march around the house on the inside. I'd pray over every single thing they had. They'd get under conviction whenever they touched it, or whenever they saw it, or when they're sitting down in a chair, whatever it was, and just praying God would save them. And then he said, Lord don't really deal with me like he used to. That's scary. It was in the early 1990s. He said, it was like in the late 1980s, God really spoke to me and dealt with me, but he don't deal with me like that anymore. We just kept praying and trusting God. And one night, it was on a Wednesday, he had a heart attack and outside. And he was one of these people that it don't matter what your age is, as long as you can move, you weed eat. Y'all know what I mean? And you work and you do all, and that's what he was doing. That's where he was. And so he had a heart attack. He's in the hospital. And as soon as I came home, I was coming home from church. We went by the hospital. I was standing at this hospital bed, at the foot of the bed. He is grinning from ear to ear. He just had a heart attack. He was grinning from ear to ear. He was about 82 or 83 years old. I believe he was 83 years old. He's grinning from ear to ear. I said, Paul, you doing all right? Yeah, I'm good. I'm like, man, you had a heart attack. He said, all right, I'm good with what happened before the heart attack. I'm like, what are you talking about? He was at home, and he trusted Jesus as his Lord and Savior at home by himself. He trusted it. You know what happened, though? That word that had been put in there all those years, God let him see what it was, see himself lost, and he trusted Jesus. And he asked the Lord to save him. And after he walked into the house and sat down, he had a heart attack. He said, man, it feels good. I thought you just had, yeah, but whenever you get saved, God changes everything. Amen. I thought, man, whenever he gets saved, I'm probably going to just ruin. I'm probably going to scream, shout, and holler and all this. I stood at the bottom of his bed astonished like these were. Wow, God, look what you just did. And that's what they said, God, look what you just did. They were astonished, the Bible says. And after that, Peter said, hey, he said, I want to let y'all know something. He said, it's time to go out and tell. He said, go and show these things unto James and to the brethren. Wow, let everybody know. There's more than one James, by the way. And he departed and went into another place. So what did Peter do after he got released? He just kept going and doing what he was doing before. He kept sharing Jesus. And the Bible says then, in verse number 18 and 19, says, and now as soon as it was day. You know what King Herod had been waiting on? He'd been waiting on daylight. He was waiting to go get Peter out of that prison. And the Bible says, now as soon as it was day, there was no small stir among the soldiers What was become of Peter? They are running around the prison. There's two of them running around. That's got chains hanging off their arm that was chained to Peter. He's no longer here. They're searching every cent. They searched the canteen. They have been everywhere, all over the prison. They've been over the bars, under the bar. They've looked everywhere for Peter. There's no small stir. The Bible says in verse number 19, he said, and when Herod had sought for him and found him not, he examined the keepers and commanded that they should be put to death. Wow. There was a big penalty for losing Peter. And that penalty was that they were going to die. This stirring enraged Herod so much, he called for them to die rather than Herod repenting. What happened in Herod's life? Instead of saying, look, there's been a miracle that's taken place. God has totally opened the eyes of us, and we've seen that God did a miracle. They rejected the miracle, and they rebelled even greater, and he asked for others' lives to be taken. Can I just let you know something about Satan? He will never be satisfied with just one being taken. He always does greater damage. And that's exactly what happened in their life. So guess what? How many of us know somebody that's in chains to something tonight? They're bound in something. It may be alcohol. It may be drugs. It may be pornography. It may be religion. There's people that are bound today, but there's a Savior who is able. And when we commit, like the church did in Acts chapter number 12, to be the prayer warriors and the trumpeters of God, to say, God, we're going to stand before you until we see their life change. Now, I want to ask y'all an honest question. Can y'all be honest tonight since we're in church? You ever been praying for somebody and you kind of just, I don't mean this in a bad way, but you just kind of got tired of praying for them? You ever just been praying and thought, Lord, I'm really not sure. I know you're good and I know you're able, but I just don't see nothing happening in their lives. And then you kind of get what it says in the book of Galatians. You kind of get weary in well-doing. It's like, God, I'm not really seeing this change. I'm not seeing this happen. And then before you know it, you think, oh, no. It's been a week since I prayed for that person, or it's been a few days since I prayed for that person, or maybe even a year since I prayed for that person. God, renew that fire. God, help me to see that they are in chains and send my heart to not ceasing to pray for them. Hey, it's time tonight, church, for us to realize what is going on around us, to awaken us to pray, that God will set us free and God will open our eyes to walk forward into what God would have for us as a church in 2020 to glorify and magnify the name of Jesus, because everybody needs who? Everybody needs Jesus. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, thank you tonight for your word. Thank you for the work of the Holy Spirit. God, thank you, God, for how you worked in Peter's life. God, thank you for how you worked in the church's life as they turned and they began to pray. And they began to believe you and trust you, God, to bring light and life to Peter. They trusted you, God, Lord, to release him from prison. They trusted you, God, to continue that ministry. They trusted you, God, to come against every single odd that was against Peter's life. Lord, they trusted you to come against Satan himself. They trusted you to come against the one that was being a vessel of Satan, King Herod. God, they trusted you. And Lord, I know tonight, God, we can do the same thing for those around us who are bound in chains. Lord, who are bound, God, in chains of addictions, who are bound in chains of things that are keeping them, maybe a past in their life, or maybe something that no one else knows about that is hidden in their life. God, maybe we don't even see it, but Lord, I know, God, there's things that are keeping people from knowing you. God, help us. Help us, Lord, God, to be that vessel, to be used, God, that they may come to know and trust in you. Father, I praise you that you know what we need. You know where we are. God, I praise you that you're in control. With heads bowed and eyes closed for just a minute, you say, you know something tonight, Pastor, I have somebody in my life that are in some chains. They've just got some things in their life. It might be a mom, a dad, a brother, a sister, a child, somebody I have personally in my life that, boy, I'd like to see God take the chains off them. Would you just slip your hand as a testimony to heaven? God, I want to see you work in their life. Oh, wow. Let's agree together for them right now for that person. Father, in the name of Jesus, you are greater than everything that is holding this person back from you. And God, right now, we just call out to you to ask you, God, to bring light, to bring life, to bring hope, to bring liberty. God, to tear down every single thing that Satan has put in their life to keep them from knowing and trusting and believing in you. God, we know they're looking for that one excuse. They have many things around their life, but they're looking for that one excuse to blame you, to blame us as a Christian, or to blame the church. God, instead, Lord, may they see that you are the only answer that they have. God, help us not to cease to pray for them until we see them released from the bondage of Satan in the name of Jesus and in the blood, by the blood of Jesus, God, that they would be totally released, totally set free, totally changed for your honor and glory. Father, I know, God, that you are the God of purpose. Lord, you didn't save us just to take us to heaven. That's just the benefit of it. God, you saved us to be your vessel. And God, we want to be a vessel in this person's life that they could come to know you. God, use us for your glory, God, in their lives. Lord, I want to give you praise and thanksgiving for what you're going to do. May there be a knock on the gate tonight. God, may there be an opening of the prison in their life for your glory. God, we give you glory and we give you praise for how you answer prayer. Tonight you may say, Pastor, you know something? I got something personal in my life tonight that I need those chains to fall off from. I want to let you know something. God has promised in his word that if you and I will confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. There also may be things in your life that have gotten you bound and holding you back. Can I let you know God is able and God wants to break those chains? Let's pray for that. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus in our own life. God, you know the struggles that every single person on this earth faces. And God, right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, we pray against those struggles. God, we pray against their sin. God, we pray against those things that Satan uses battles against us with to try to break us down and keep us from following after you. God, we pray against them in your name. And God, we ask for your encouragement. God, we ask for your strength. We ask for your power through your word. Oh, God, to be strengthened in the inner man by the Holy Ghost, God, that you may use us as your vessel. Father, I praise you for what you're going to do. God, and I give you glory. You're able to release us from the inner prison. God, to give us life and light and love. And God, from that, send us forth as a light and testimony of what you can do in our lives. We give you glory. And with heads bowed and eyes closed, just a minute, as we finish praying tonight, you say, Pastor, I'm not sure I know Christ. Hey, can I tell you, this is the place where you ask Jesus to come in your life. It's because he died on a cross for our sins. He was buried and he rose again, and he asked us to come to him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, you shall be saved. It's a great time to ask Jesus to come in your life. Let's pray together. Father, we love you tonight. Thank you that you made salvation so simple. God, you said all of us that we'd recognize that we have sinned against you. And God, in sinning against you, we understand, God, that it's our nature to sin against you. We are all sinners. And Father, we ask for your forgiveness because we believe that Jesus died on a cross. He was buried and he rose again. And today, Jesus, we receive your word, we receive your forgiveness, and we receive your salvation. And tonight, Jesus, we just want to tell you thank you for saving us. Thank you for the blood that was shed so we can know you. God, help us to live for you. Help us to lift you up and help us to love you and serve you every day of our life. Help us to honor you in everything we do. We give you glory in the name and the precious and wonderful name of Jesus. We pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. How many of you are glad God does answer prayer? Amen. Amen. We give God praise tonight. Thank you so much for being in the house of the Lord. I want to ask you tonight, from tonight all the way through Sunday, I want